He's about 455 yards away. He's going to hit about a 2-iron, I think.
This is the School of Motion podcast. Come for the MoGraph, stay for the puns.
The more I say, me, I'm OS Casey, the more familiar I am with how to break down what a sentence looks like. So a sentence in CG, be it like a whole bunch of MoGraph cubes falling downstairs in like an animated GIF loop, it's the same principles. Use and practice lead to a better utilization of a language.
There are definitely many routes into the motion design industry. Some people come in through the art side. They love design, they love animation, they love making beautiful images, and then all the technical skills come along later. Our guest today came into the industry, kind of like I did, from the opposite end, the technical side. Cinema 4D artist extraordinaire Casey Hupke graduated with a degree in computer science, and a few years later found himself working on stage visuals for U2 and Lady Gaga concerts. Somewhere along the way, he managed to pick up an absurd amount of software skills, and more importantly, a really good eye for design. His work is kind of that perfect blend of insane technical execution and beautiful design-driven imagery. In this interview, we talk about how his computer science background has helped him in this field, how he approaches learning new skills, especially really difficult ones, and what it's like working on a huge production for a rock star. If you're into 3D, if you're a Cinema 4D fan, you'll love this episode. And before we jump in, I want to mention that we are, in fact, building our first Cinema 4D course as we speak. I don't want to say too much more about it at this point, but I can guarantee you it will blow minds when we launch it in 2018. If you'd like more information about it when it launches, head on over to schoolofmotion.com and sign up for a free student account. You'll get access to tons of free project files and downloads on the site, and you'll get our weekly Motion Mondays newsletter, which covers industry news and keeps you up to date on anything new and exciting we're up to. So that's it. Let's talk to Casey. Casey, it is awesome to have you on the School of Motion podcast. Big fan of your work, and I'm thrilled to have you on. So thanks for coming on, man.
Not a problem. I listened to the podcast, so I'm excited to be on it.
Excellent, excellent. All right, well, let's start, you know, with a little bit of background. Everyone listening to this, you know, go to Casey's website. We're going to link to it in the show notes. Look at his work. It's really beautiful, super technical stuff. But just so everyone can get a little bit better picture of Casey Hupke, where are you living right now and where are you working?
I live in the east side of Los Angeles in a place called Eagle Rock. It's a fun little neighborhood, family-oriented now. It wasn't when we bought a home 7 years ago. But currently I'm staff. I'm the director of visual effects, in charge of all the motion graphics for a data science company called Silence. They create an AI-based antivirus software. You guys can look into them. It's C-Y-L-A-N-C-E. But yeah, I make a bunch of like trade show graphics, booth graphics, like all the wallpapers and desktops and stuff, like website graphics. I've been building an AR application with them for a few, you know, probably a year. We've been developing it, and it's a really fun, like practical data visualization of what the product captures when it stops a threat from harming your computer, and basically just taking that data and trying to figure out how to apply AR to it. So I'm in what I would consider my dream job right now.
That's fascinating. All right, so let's start with you bought a home in Los Angeles. How did you manage to do that? All of my friends who live in Los Angeles wish they could buy homes. Did you find the one that was affordable?
Yeah. So 7 years ago, if everyone remembers from LA, it was a bubble, and actually everywhere in the world or in the country. Sorry to sound so North American centric by saying the world there, world. but yeah, so the market popped. All the loans that were you gave everyone their first home, they imploded and all the houses got foreclosed. Cut to my wife and I and her brother, hey, let's buy a house. And we started looking for places together, found a place in Eagle Rock that had sold a year prior for 60% more than it was on sale for now. Swooped in, bought it. There was a whole bunch of sold as-is conditions that revealed themselves over the last 7 years, but for the most part, turned out to be the smartest investment I've ever, you know, made, because we're now in like a an excellent school district and an excellent neighborhood, and we're here. We're fortunate. We're very fortunate. Yeah.
Sure, the equity in your house has probably grown pretty good since then too. So you know, listening to you tell that story, I mean, it's pretty obvious. Like you're a very smart guy. You're very cerebral, and I was doing my Google stalking on you. Your about page on your website says you have a background in computer science, which is fascinating to me. I mean, it's very rare that I say, how did you get into motion design? And someone says, oh, I went to college and studied it, and then I got recruited, and now I have a job. You know, everyone comes from a different place. So I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit about your background in computer science and how you ended up in this world.
Oh, yeah, sure. So I left high school on the back of the California High School Proficiency Exam, which is a test for Californians that allows children or adolescents of the age of 16 and older to pay a small fee, to take a test that's a 60% pass or fail test, and you're out of high school. My plan was to become an awesome hacker and go to school to become a programmer and make video games and, you know, live the hacker dream. So I started going to junior college, was taking some computer science classes, took like VB and C, and I found out that, you know, the college environment to a 16, 17-year-old was a lot more like, wow, look how easy it is to have fun and party and not go to school. And so I quickly stopped going, jumped ahead a couple years. I was still very much into computers. And what I was mainly doing was creating like front-end user interfaces for tools for this small group of hackers or penetration testers. And I was basically just like making all their applications have better UX and UI. And just loved sort of graphic design. Didn't really ever learn it before. I was just teaching it to myself as I went along. Started a little small hacker zine called iGlitch. It was a Macintosh-based hacking and security magazine that lived for about 4 issues on the internet. And I found this company, Exopolis, which this audience may remember from doing the best iPod commercial with the neon trails and everything.
Yep.
So I started there as a part-time IT guy. And just because I came in for an interview and was like, I like creative stuff. I'm a creative person. I like computers. That's the short version of like the 3,000 word email I sent the founder of the company. That he liked to bring up every year. Like, look at this email that Casey sent when he was such a young kid. So anyway, part-time IT guy. One day they asked me to come full-time, so I quit the schooling that I was doing then, which was again like a game design program at Westwood College Online. I dropped out of that, went full-time IT, jumping ahead a little bit more. This guy's render keeps crashing on the farm that I built. It's in Cinema 4D. I open up Cinema 4D's help manual, start reading through it, notice that the GI sampling and a couple other things in his scene are just set to sort of what the defaults were. I tweaked them a little bit and explained what the GI settings did to this guy, who was a well-seasoned Cinema 4D professional, who I had no idea who he was at the time, and he became one of my favorite people to work with. He probably doesn't even remember this. It was so long ago. So my boss gets wind that I'm troubleshooting people's render files now that are going on the farm. And he goes, you like this stuff? Do you want to do some of this stuff? And I was like, yeah, sure. So I start fixing files and becoming a render wrangler. Then I start clipping out stuff in Photoshop and rotoscoping and After Effects. And then I'm helping out doing like alt sets of boards. And then I'm animating on projects. And then before I left, I was a lead 3D animator. And I slowly tripped into new roles in the company because I was like, well, no one's doing this, I'll do this. Well, no one's learning this, I'll do this. Like, I learned thinking particles because we had no one to do particles. And I learned Espresso because we had no one to learn Espresso. And so I've always just kind of found a hole and been like, I can get in there and I can help and wear this hat. And that's sort of how I ended up now where I am.
That is one of the craziest like origin stories I think I've ever heard in this industry. That's amazing. So Exopolis, for anyone listening that hasn't heard of it, sort of legendary, you know, studio, not around anymore. And yeah, the big thing that I remember was that iPod commercial. And I believe you'd probably know, Casey, the two founders of Royale were there, and I think they worked on that, right?
Yeah, I got to work under some of the best people in the industry still today while I was there. Brian Holman and Jason Whitmore both taught me basically every single thing that I consider worth remembering about After Effects and Photoshop. Magnus Hiarta and Greg Reynard taught me all the foundational skills that I have for Cinema 4D today. Greg Reynard taught me a ton about Espresso. And I remember one day, Greg, who's done some amazing title sequences like War of the Worlds and other like amazing sequences from IF, I was trying to make an Espresso script look better, and he gave me one of the best pieces of advice for anyone using learning Node-based stuff right now. I was like, yeah, I want to make this cleaner and look a little better. And he was like, what, do you put Node layouts on your reel now?
That's really good advice. Yeah, it's like, you know, fixate on the things that people are going to see, and, you know, the rest of it you just sweep under the carpet when the job's done, right?
Yeah. Even, like, David Lewandowski worked there for a while, and, everyone in LA that is now like doing really well was at Exopolis for some time.
Yeah, it was kind of the stomping grounds. And David Lewandowski, by the way, is one of my favorite people I've ever met. I've only met him once in person. He had a very, very large impact on me. So, okay, so let's go back to the hacker days a little bit. I want to dig into that. So you mentioned you were working with, and I've never heard this term before, penetration testers.
Yeah.
It's hard for me to say it with a straight face. So was this like an actual, like a company, like a security company that went out and tried to like, you know, sort of kick the tires for other companies? Or was this a group of hackers trying to, you know, do the things that we saw in the movie Hackers in 1993 or whenever it came out?
Actual hacking looks horrible to watch. It's boring. It's the most boring thing in the world. It just open up a notepad and just type the same word over and over. That's basically what you're going to see when you try to watch someone hack. But yeah, it was a group of like remote people, and they would get hired by companies to test their networking and security. I did a lot of like phone operations and stuff. Like I would call companies and see how much information I can get from a company just based on talking to them. And the thing that I learned from that is that if you ever need to get information or ever need to get someone on a phone anywhere, just call accounts, ask for accounts payable, because those people think that when they answer the phone, someone's going to give their company money, and they're going to answer the phone without a hold.
That's a really good tip.
So yeah, so I worked with these guys, and we'd be like, oh, such and such company in Alberta has an office. They want us to see what kind of information we can gather. They want to do a phone test, and then they also want to do an external security audit. So the hacker guys, like the talented guys that knew actually how to like program and script and exploit things, they would do all their stuff. And then I would try to like learn along the way, like scripting and like, you know, Python and Perl and stuff like that to sort of help out. But mainly I worked the phones, and then would make desktop wallpapers and do graphic design for things that we needed things reskinned or whatever.
Super interesting. All right. And so then you sort of, you know, you fell into little opportunities. You learn, you know, you learned that, oh, I can help debug renders. And I love the example you used of, you know, the GI sample settings were too high or something like that. That's the type of thing that a lot of Cinema 4D artists just don't even want to bother with. And so there needs to be Casey Hupke's out there who kind of have the left brain and the right brain, you know, together to look at that kind of stuff. So when I was looking at your work and I was kind of reading the descriptions, it occurred to me like you sound like you've kind of found this niche. Like you're the guy that can figure out the crazy technical stuff. Is that accurate?
Yeah, I sort of while I was working at I think like the most formidable years for that character arc to develop was when I was working at Motion Theory with my friend John Robson, another amazingly talented technical left brain, right brain person who's also a crazy talented director. We met and started working on a project at Motion Theory together. And then we worked on an infinite amount of projects together at Motion Theory and Murata after that. And we both realized that we had, if it was just him and I creating tools and reverberating off each other to challenge each other more and learn new stuff off each other, it was basically just like this infinite feedback loop of more complicated stuff. And then like we would get our idea, I'd build a tool, and then I'd push that tool out to the other cinema artists that were on the job, or I would try to come up with like an Espresso setup or a rig for like a complicated data viz setup, or just a utility. Like people would ask me at Motion Theory, like, hey, is there a way to do this? Can you make a thing that just does this? So I like quickly fell into like a pseudo technical art director role for like effects for DataViz. Like like it was like the Buick job into the IBM jobs, into the Intel jobs, into the Exxon jobs, and AT&T, and all that stuff was like more or less John Robson and I and a handful of other artists just seeing what crazy shit we can get out of cinema. Oop, can I curse on here?
Oh, absolutely.
All right, fuck.
Fuck yeah.
But yeah, so yeah, I quickly started becoming more technical direction mode, which was great because I always hated using After Effects and I didn't want to comp my renders anymore.
Okay, let's dig there. So why did you hate After Effects? And it doesn't surprise me to hear you say that because your work is clearly very, very 3D technically oriented. But I'm just curious, what was it about After Effects or 2D in general that kind of pushed you away?
It was mainly, it was the thing that I could never troubleshoot. It was always the thing that, like, when you're at the studio and you're sitting in a circle of 17 computers, and no matter how many times I'd, like, copy the command line code to start a net render in Terminal and IM it to the 16 other computers and run over and launch them all four times, you know, there'd always be, like, one weird thing that would happen where, you'd hear a sea of infinite goats dying in the background and all of the renders go crashing down. And it's 4 a.m. and you're trying to get out just an image sequence so that you can convert it to a ProRes and make your posting by 6 a.m. It always seemed like After Effects was the thing that was holding us back from being on time. And then, you know, then we started working with Nuke and Nuke compositors and other compositors. And it wasn't After Effects. It's just the nature of the beast. When it's 4 a.m., there's going to be a problem. But the PTSD is that goat in my head at 4 a.m.
Yeah, well, I get you. I mean, you know, I haven't worked on jobs of that scope, but I've, you know, After Effects is the end of the pipeline usually, at least in terms of unless you're going to edit something afterwards, and it's a little more of a black box than Cinema 4D and especially Nuke, and if you know, of course, if you get into Houdini, things like that, everything's exposed to you, and it's a lot easier to debug and troubleshoot in After Effects. You know, it's gotten better about that. You know,
yeah,
it seems like your skill set plugs in better to things that give you all, you know. It's like an open kimono and you can do what you gotta do.
I really like I've been compositing primarily for the past like 2 years-ish in Fusion. And I love the way it handles data. Like you can bring in like 10 gigabytes of multi-layered EXR 32-bit 4K sequences and comp and render and just, there's no other plugins involved. It's just you and Fusion and you submit it to your render Wrangler application like Deadline or whatever you use and it just renders.
Yeah. I haven't used Fusion, but I've used Nuke a lot. And you know, it feels like I don't know, it's a workhorse. It just gets it done. It doesn't, you know, it doesn't look all that pretty, but you can rely on it. And After Effects is my bread and butter. So I don't like to say bad things about it, but it doesn't feel that way yet. Hopefully yeah. It gets there.
I want After Effects. I want it to become the thing that they're trying to build it to be, hopefully. Like to me, it looks like it's like a long time ago, a rock hit the After Effects windshield and it made a chip and then it started fracturing out from there. And now that fracture is going across the whole windshield and it's trying to grab all the different things and like cater all the markets. But it's only really suited for like a specific animation type market. And even then I feel like it's bread and butter. The shape layer is just cracking under old age and becoming difficult for the people that even just like live off of explainer videos use it for, you know. It's something that I feel like they all know, and I think everyone's yelling about it, and I love the team. Like Tim and Victoria are awesome, and if anyone's ever interacted with them, you'll know that they're like the nicest people who are open to feedback. And I can't wait for the day where I open After Effects and I'm like, I love this.
Yeah, I think, you know, After Effects in particular, they're juggling so many different things. One, it's this, in terms of software, it's ancient. And I'm sure you've got a lot of code debt and legacy code in there that's going to be really hard to unwind. But I also think, too, you know, you look at a piece of software like Cinema 4D, which it's in my opinion, maybe you disagree, but in my opinion, it's more difficult to learn. It's much deeper. It exposes far more of the underbelly of what's going on. And for the type of work that's on your website, you need all that power. And it requires, to some extent, like bigger teams and render farms and people. Whereas After Effects is designed so that one person can do a 2-minute explainer video in a week and you can kind of get it done and it's going to look pretty good. But in order to have that speed, I think you have to lose a little bit of the... customizability and all that kind of stuff. I'm curious, do you agree with that?
Yeah, I'd agree with that. But at the same time, like someone like EJ from iDesign would just go, oh no, hold on. Like, look at this like entire series I've made on animating Sketchintune with like two or three deformers. And so, I mean, I think they're both suited for that sort of that world. It's just, cinema has, when I first started learning cinema, I was coming from After Effects. Like, After Effects was my favorite thing ever. Like, someone turned me on to Particular, and I was like, this is so amazing. Particular is the best thing in the world. And I just jumped right into cinema and just started immediately going, oh, wow, MoGraph is really cool. This is awesome. What else can I do with this? And that's one of the things that cinema really has going for it is, I think it's just, you can look at the icons on the top of the screen and be like, okay, well, that's going to make this thing. What's this thing do? And I think cinema is really easy to like get in and start learning by experimentation. Other packages aren't so much.
Yeah, exactly. I remember a long time ago, I decided, okay, it's time I learned 3D, and I tried to learn Maya. And Maya, you know, I know Maya artists would disagree, but I don't think Maya is set up that way. It's not set up where you can just kind of figure it out. You know, yeah. it's where cinema, it's, you know, it's logical once you learn sort of how like the object manager works and like, okay, you parent this and then it causes this to happen. I think it makes a lot of sense. So, okay, so let's dig into kind of your role once you kind of got into the motion design world. So, you know, motion theory, a lot of the work that you did there, I mean, it's gorgeous. Like, you know, the spots you worked on, and I know that you were working as part of a team. So I'm curious what your role was at that point. Like, were you doing look development as well as kind of building these rigs to help other artists, or were you being given a set of boards and being told, we have no idea how we're going to animate this, figure out how we're going to do it?
It was both. So again, John and I, we would often either start the job at the exact same time and do look dev together, or I would be working on a pitch and John would be on the job and then I'd start and work with John, or John would be on a pitch and I'd start the job and then John would come on and work with me. But it was really like, and I'm going to try to remember all of their names, at least first names. It was like Satomi and Paul and Angela and Chris and Heidi and Casey and all these other designers that were there. They had this really like photographic filmic style board process, and Matt Cullen and Javier and Mark Kutzi, they would all push for these really like realistic effects from this data visualization style that we were really trying to sort of like create at the time. It was like, you know, what we've all called like the birth of chromatic aberrations, particles, and thin lines. And that everything we did was like, all right, more chroma ab, a little more lens distortion on this, like, you know, this additive effect, this thing that like looks like a hologram. Let's make it not look like a hologram. We tried to like have like certain rules that we'd apply to this data viz style that we were creating. And then in cinema, we'd have to recreate these style frames that were made from like photographic components. Like, it'd be like, you know, real like polar coordinate solar flare stuff, like hue shifted and warped over the surface of an object with chromatic aberrations and bokeh baked into it. And then we'd have to figure out in 3D how to make that. And more times than not, it was a whole bunch of circle splines or traced splines rendered with the hair renderer with slight transparency added over a couple times in After Effects with Sapphire Warp Chroma. And like, that was basically like a formula that we started building. And then as soon as we started like getting like a language built in that world, we would make stuff for the designers. The designers would ask for things. And it was just a really collaborative circle of, I want to say like a core team of like eight people that were really responsible for a lot of that look dev that came out. And it was a real collaborative process, like a real, like, there was no real like org chart to it. Like, it's hard for anyone to really claim, like, I think it would be wrong for anyone to claim ownership over what we all did there, because everyone was so integral in the process of developing those looks.
It sounds like a really fun environment to be in. And that's actually always been my favorite part of motion design. You know, you get a set of boards and the designer found a cool photo of like a, you know, a long exposure or something and just put it in. And then you're like, all right, I need to make this art directable and animatable and basically make a rig that rebuilds this thing. And it's fun. It's like a puzzle. And that's kind of that's a part of motion design that some people don't like. You know, there are designers out there that want no part of that. They just want to make the picture and think up the thing and give it to you. So, you know, especially as a 3D artist, you have to be somewhat of a technician. Do you have you seen in your career that like there are some 3D artists that are like pure art side, and then there are some that are pure technical side? And don't ask me to like make a style frame. Or do you have to be kind of a combo to be successful at that level?
It's in LA, at least from my experience, the people that I work with the most that are at they're like, you know, on the top or whatever, they're capable of doing style frames and finishing shots. And I don't think that they had to. I just think that we have such a good pool of artists in this area that this is, people are capable of doing that. I think that you can totally be a technical 3D artist that when asked to do look dev says, I don't do that. Like I make the dev. Like I'll like you show me what you want, and then I'll make a train that goes around the tracks and turns into a robot. But don't ask me to come up with something cool, because that's going to make my palms sweat and I'm going to have a panic attack and I'm not going to be able to see for an hour.
Exactly. Yeah, I can commiserate with that. So, you know, you didn't go to school for design and you know, have classes where you were learning how to come up with concepts and do, you know, essentially concept art. And yet you're, you know, basically now you're doing that. So how did you develop your eye for that stuff and your sense of design? I mean, obviously you were always sort of technically inclined, so you had that. But how did you get the other part?
I think I've always sort of been, this sounds so douchey, but I think I've been artistically aware since I was like a teenager. Like I remember like, all right. So yeah, I used to do a lot of acid and,
fair enough.
I remember the first time, like I really tripped out on parallax. Like I was just riding the bus and I was just like staring at all these buildings and telephone poles and stuff go by as the bus was driving on the freeway. And I was just very, very, very aware of parallax and Z depth. And I remember just tripping out. And I remember like that was something that I kind of took with me into like animation. Like I always liked using like long lenses and stuff, or anything that would like exaggerate a sense of distance or whatever. And I never like without the design, like the lack of a design education hurt me along the way, embarrassingly at times, where I would be like, well, I was using a Fresnel shader around the edge to get it a little bit more reflective, like the Fresnel does, to a room of people that were like Art Center alums staring at me going, it's Fresnel, dude.
I was about to ask you. I was like, oh shit, I've been saying it wrong the whole time.
No. So like, you know, or I'd be making something and someone would be like, that looks a lot like blah, 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 like some other artist or, you know, fine artist or graphic designer. And I don't know who any of those people are. And then I'd look into it and be like, wow, I guess it sort of looks like that, except for the fact that this is much better. And I don't know what I'm doing here. But I don't know. I just kind of shed all of those, like those requirements from my head. And I was just like, I think this is a good frame. I'm getting positive response by doing this stuff. And I'm not afraid to ask someone else what they think, and I take criticisms, and I was fortunate to work with some of the best people in LA along the way, and learn tricks and tips that I've sort of adopted or expanded on in my own way. And you know, I feel like those formative years of like Exopolis and Motion Theory and Logan, definitely just through osmosis, I got like the best design education on the job that I could ever have gotten at school.
Yeah, I love that you use the word osmosis. I mean, that's how I picked it up too. I think if you can be lucky enough to be in a position where you're looking at great designers designing all day, then you just sort of calibrate your eye to what they're doing. And then in my case, you know, I had to make a conscious effort at times to reverse engineer what they were doing. You know, like you'd see a cool style frame and you'd say, what is cool about it? And then you'd open up their Photoshop file and you'd see, oh, there's a vignette. And then there's like, then they blurred just this corner over here. And that, to me, it was like, that's how I describe it, reverse engineering. So did you ever make a conscious effort to like, okay, I need to get better at color, so I'm going to work on that and do everydays or something? Or did you just sort of take years and years to develop?
No, I never did everydays. I always overused color a lot, like in like some of my early boards and stuff. My mentor in design and cinema, Magnus Yarta, he we were doing some boards for this Xbox project, and I had just done like a series of boards for a pitch before that, like, and he was like, all right, from now on, like going forward, you're not allowed to use cyan and magenta, like anymore. Like, stop using stop using cyan and magenta overlays on everything. Just you're just done. You're just no more.
Yeah. You know, when you don't have a design education, like when I started out and being asked to design stuff, it was always about like, well, design means it has to look cool, right? And if it's not obviously cool, then I didn't do a good job. And then, you know, that's how you lose all sense of subtlety. And luckily I learned my lesson, and being slapped around by art directors definitely helped. So I want to ask you about, you've got an interesting skill set with your 3D skills and your design skills and your conceptual skills, you know, but you've been doing this for a while. So what's the bar now to be a hireable, let's say, freelance cinema 4D artist at a studio in LA? Like, how good do you have to be? What sort of, can you just be a technician? Do you need the creative side? Like, what's the bar?
It's hard. I don't know. It's hard. Honestly, like, when it comes to hiring people for projects, I mainly go off of like the conversational aspects. Like, can we communicate? Like, if we talk for like 10, 15 minutes in a conference room or at coffee or something, and we have a good conversation, then I feel like that's really all I need from a person on a team who's using cinema. Or, you know, because I feel like the technical ability of someone that is learning cinema now, or is like a year or two into learning cinema, is almost better than like a cinema generalist from 5 years ago. Actually, no, I would say it's definitely better than someone from 5 years ago, just because of the how the application has grown and the plugins and tools we have available, how the community is. Like, there's a lot of, you know, dailies copying and like regurgitation and stuff, but all that stuff's like super valuable. Like, that's all reverse engineering and hacking. And then I feel like the best of those people, when they get on a job, they've learned tricks to apply to their required tasks that are making them better. So
you sort of start, you know, I think it may change in the near future, because, you know, you've got companies like ours and Nick over at Grayscale, you know, starting to create classes and structure around learning cinema 4D. But really, up until this point, it's been tutorial binging and playing and experimenting. There hasn't been really a structured way to do it. So, you know, a lot of people listening are probably in that phase right now. They're in the tutorial binge mode, and they're on Grayscale Gorilla every day trying to absorb three or four tutorials. And, you know, you kind of alluded to it, that like when you're there, it's really easy to just copy. You know, like, well, I'm going to take that tutorial, but it's going to be blue and there's gonna be less, you know, bump or whatever. And that now that's mine. How do you move past that and start to use these things in a way that makes you useful to the industry?
So I see every single thing, the way you learn everything is sort of like how you learn to communicate with people. Like, communicating via software, using software is like a language. There's actually someone, I just saw a blog, I can't remember who it is, but if you Google or Bing or Yahoo, Houdini as a language, it's a really interesting breakdown of like the vocabulary of the software Houdini. And I think that I've applied that to the way that I've learned the majority of things. Like, tutorials and everything are great because they're sort of like Duolingo, where I'm like, me llamo es Casey. And I learn how to say, my name is Casey. And I may just be copying the thing that just said, my name is Casey, but I've learned some fundamentals there in the structure of a sentence. And the more I say, me llamo es Casey, the more familiar I am with how to break down what a sentence looks like. So a sentence in CG, be it like a whole bunch of MoGraph cubes falling downstairs in like an animated GIF loop, it's the same principles. Use and practice lead to a better utilization of a language. So I think the same thing applies to every single thing that you're learning. And I think copying and tutorial binging and all that stuff is valuable, because it's effort that you're putting out there to learn something. Obviously, if you're only opening up free C4D files or free Houdini files from any of the various learning solutions and changing a color and rendering it and posting it, you're never going to progress. But if you're analytically looking at things to get better at an ability, then you're going to level up and get better as you go, because you're putting in the effort to get a change.
Right. So you basically need to draw out the principles, I guess, from the cool thing that you just watched. So if it's cubes falling down a stair, what are the principles that you're learning, and kind of be conscious about it? You know, like, okay, well, I'm learning about dynamics and rigid body collisions. Okay, cool. So I'm not learning how to make cubes fall down a staircase. And I think that's a good mindset to be in when you're watching a tutorial. And obviously the better tutorial makers out there, you know, Nick and Chris and Chad, they know that going in. So they design the learning to look cool and suck you in, but also to teach you that stuff. So I want to ask you about some of the stuff you've learned. You have stuff on your reel you have a lot of X particles. You seem to be a pretty big fan of X particles, and there's all these different renderers. I guess you're using cycles now. I saw some turbulence, and for people who don't know, so X particles, particle plugin for Cinema 4D. Cycles is a third party renderer for Cinema 4D. Turbulence is a simulation tool for Cinema 4D that can create volumetric smoke and fire. And Krakatoa, which I'm not even exactly sure what that is. I believe it's like a renderer for particles or something like that. But anyway, it's a lot of really technical stuff, Casey. How did you learn all of this stuff? I mean, learning one of those is a big task, but you know like 10 different ones.
Yeah, I mean, I consider myself pretty well versed in like Octane and Cycles and Arnold and Turbulence and Krakatoa and everything. A lot of the tools that I've learned, specifically like turbulence and like thinking particles, those came from accepting jobs to use those things early on.
Yes.
And I did not use them. So I was like, I look, open the documentation and be like, this is like 15 pages. How fucking hard could this be? It usually hard, but because I'm like under the wire, I just buckle down and learn and experiment and iterate. And I don't recommend it unless you have like a supportive partner, or you just live alone, or you.
Right.
But yeah, so I like throwing myself into situations that require dramatic change to get a dramatic result. So challenging myself with new software or new techniques is something that I've always enjoyed doing.
Yeah, I'm really glad that you put it that way. I agree 100%. I would actually. I mean, yes, with the caveat of like, you know, if you're married and you have three kids and you require a lot of sleep, maybe don't say yes to the job that requires, you know, turbulence, realistic smoke, and you've never used it before. But that is how I've learned every complex thing that I've ever learned is by saying yes. And I actually had a job for it was for Bertucci's. It's like a pizza chain in New England. And we needed fire and smoke that was art directable. And that's how I learned turbulence. And you do that enough times and all of a sudden you kind of pick this stuff up. So you learn that stuff just in time. Now, one of the biggest issues I see specifically with our students that are learning 3D is shiny object syndrome. So I think, you know, you could use Cinema 4D for a decade and still not really know every little piece of it. But we have a lot of students that learn it for 3 months and then they want to jump right into Houdini. Or they're like, you know, I saw a thread recently that was like, ah, man, I still haven't learned Redshift and Octane and Cycles. Now I got to learn Arnold too, you know. So I'm wondering, you know, do you see this out in the wild, like out in the industry? Do people act this way too? And what would you say to people who are new to the world of 3D that are very quickly going to find out about Octane and think that that's cool? And then they're going to see somebody who's brilliant in Houdini and think they need that.
Oh, I don't know. It's out there a lot. Like, I mean, I started using Houdini in version 15. Yeah, 15. 15. I got hit up by a company that does spas, and they were like, "Hey, we really want to get this spa. We want it to like get pour. We want this water to just like fall into this tank, and then the water to slowly become this jacuzzi." And I was like, how long do you guys have to do it? And they're like, about 2 months. And I was like, yeah, I can do that. So I bought Houdini and started teaching myself Houdini fluid simulations. And the job came out really cool. I'll probably never put it on my reel because I'm not super happy with the way that the final mesh came out. But I learned a ton through trial by fire. Right now, there is a lot of like people looking left and right going like, oh man, look at all the hashtags on this guy's daily. It's like Houdini, Octane, Cycles, Redshift, Cinema, Photoshop, Illustrator, Adobe Bridge, Media Encoder, After Effects, Bryce. Oh my God, I gotta learn all of these things.
Right.
I think it's like, it's hashtag anxiety.
I've never heard that term. I love that.
I just came with it right now. Yeah. And I don't know what to say to people that are freaking out about having to learn all the stuff. Like, don't freak out. Like, develop your abilities at the pace that you develop them at, and focus on having a better eye, because it doesn't matter what the software you use. It's like, we're all trying to make pretty pictures. So make pretty pictures and you're going to have a career, you know.
Be
the guy that uses, or girl, that uses physical render and makes like the dopest dailies ever. Like, who cares if it took 35 minutes to render the frame? Like, making a picture. You're not marketing yourself as a leader of efficiency and minimal render time. Like, it's great to be able to do that, but, you know, it's not something that everyone has to do. Houdini is great. I love it. It makes a lot of sense to me. I use it as much as I use Cinema, but it's not the tool for every job. I mean, it's just not.
Yeah, I think that you kind of brought up a good point. I mean, you know, you have to look at what your goals are. If the goal is, I want to be a professional motion designer working on cool stuff, you could learn Cinema 4D relatively well, and it will be able to do 95% of what clients ask you to do. And then those edge cases where, yes, I need fluid simulation to fill up the shape of a hot tub, and I need the color of the water to change depending on like how big of a splash it may, you know. Yes, okay, fine. It's easier to do that in Houdini than in Cinema, but there's like these edge cases, and I think people get caught up in the fact that, you know, artists like you, that you reach those edge cases and then you use Houdini to do it and the shit looks so cool, they think that everybody needs to be able to do that. And I don't know, I always try to talk people out of learning Houdini before Cinema 4D. I'm curious what you think about that. I feel like my thing is, you know, this is your profession, and if you're just if you're an artist, you just want to make cool shit, learn whatever you want. But if you want to work in the industry, learn Cinema 4D, learn the basics of 3D, learn some modeling, some texturing principles, how to light. At that point, it doesn't matter what app you're in, you know? Like you said it, if you make a pretty picture, you're going to have work.
Yeah, so it's hard. So I consider myself a part of the Maxon family. I by no means speak on behalf of them or anything. I've you know, done tons of NABs and SIGGRAPHs with them, and I love the software to death. It's what I consider my sketchpad. If you learn Cinema 4D and you get to the point where you're not able to get what you need out of Cinema 4D, Houdini's right there. But if you aren't to the point in Cinema 4D where you're hitting the wall where you're like, man, I wish I had an arbitrary attribute attached to every nth point that gave me a different vertex weight based on the direction of the normal for how much pressure was in this pop sim over here because X particles isn't talking to the mesh the correct way, then yeah, start looking at Houdini and learning Vex and all that stuff. But if you're just like, well, I saw all these GIFs and they used Houdini, so I should learn Houdini, then just learn Cinema. You're going to make 1,000 GIFs in the time that person figured out the one GIF.
Yeah, exactly. We actually, one of our earliest episodes, we interviewed a Houdini artist for Disney. He's like an effects animator there. And I mean, I've never opened Houdini, but just talking to him and him explaining sort of how it worked, and it's like, I can see the power and it's very exciting, but at the same time, I realize that I have absolutely no, I have no need for that. I definitely have not pushed the limits of what Cinema 4D is capable of.
Yeah, it's an open-ended system that allows you to do anything you want. But as it sounds, creating anything you want requires a surmountable amount of energy to be put into it to create anything. you know, it's quick. You can iterate with it. You can build procedural systems that are easily updatable and controllable, and you can control to your heart's content. But in motion design, I mean, I don't even know if 90% of the time you need all that control. It's like, I mean, I don't know how many times I've been on a job and posted 50 iterations of something from Cinema in a dailies folder and had like version 1 or 2 be the thing that was picked, you know, like, and then run with that look for the job. Like I never need to go back to the procedural system, and, you know, or I do, but like, it's, I don't know. It's, I have fun in Houdini. I love learning it, but it doesn't feel like the tool that I'm going to like settle into as 100% usage. Like Cinema is just always going to be adding new stuff that's going to make me happier with where it's going. So.
Yeah. And of course now they work together. There's this neat bridge between them and all that. So, okay. So let's jump into a little bit of your work. So, you know, the work you're doing now, I kind of want to come back to at the end, cause I'm kind of fascinated by that, but a lot of the work, or not a lot, but like a decent amount on your site is from concert visuals. And I've never worked on concert visuals before. It seems kind of like a dream gig, right? Like you know, you have, I don't know, like Lady Gaga or something like that, and you get to have these giant 80-foot screens. So what's it like working on projects for huge acts like that?
It's really, really fun. It's a dopamine rush in both negative and positive ways. It's a lot of sleepless nights. I started doing commercial or concert graphics when I met up with this guy, Figgy, who runs a company called Possible. That was my first large concert gig. It was like working with like Deadmau5 and Timid Faith and these rad K-pop bands. And they had a system down. Like they knew how to do it. They had like Figgy was just a mad scientist genius who could make a template layout for an entire stage in a couple hours and have an entire After Effects template for rendering perspective footage to map to all the screens. For the Nicki Minaj concert that we did, he built the stage in Cinema, and then they built the stage in front of us. And we got to work in front of this giant LED projection house that was built and look at all of our footage get mapped to it. You know, we'd hire Beeple on like everything. So get to work with, you know, Beeple on something is just awesome. And then from then on, I kind of got like just super into it. And then I left for a bit and I went to work at Zoic, and one of the last things that Zoic was a company hit me up that knew that I did a bunch of concert stuff with Figgy at Possible, and he had a Lady Gaga concert and said, can you take it over? We need someone with pipeline, and I was at Zoic, so we had the pipeline, took it on and did that. For one reason or another, I wasn't at Zoic anymore, and my son was at an age where I was like, I'm not going to leave the house anymore. I'm going full Howard Hughes. I'm locking myself in my basement. And,
nice.
And a lot of remote concert jobs started popping up. And so that's how I met, that's how I got on U2. I met this guy, Ben, at Empirical Studios. And it's fun stuff. The rough part is the on-sites, because you always have to do like 2 weeks or a week at the first place that you're going to be setting up or in a rehearsal stage. And so you're away from your family. You never have enough time. Things get killed in the last minute, and then you got to completely remix something from scratch. And it's definitely some of my favorite stuff that I've worked on for sure. Is concerts and installations.
So how are the acts, you know, whoever the artist is, how are they as clients compared to normal clients?
They're completely different. So what Figgy and I did on the Tim and Faith project was we got their set list and we started at the beginning and sort of sketched out like a mood, like for each song. And then we tried to create ways to iterate along the way. Looks would get killed or designs would change and we just have to keep iterating. And then with a commercial client, posting day goes up. You have your call the next day. You talk about the call. You get the notes. You go back to work for a day or two. Post again. Day or two goes by. You get notes. You make iterations. That's like a week of work.
Right.
And on a concert, you're posting like every half day and getting feedback and turning around. And like it's for when you're on sites, like when you're at the set, you'll watch the stuff on the big screens, on the stages. Get notes and then go back to where your computer is behind the stage and immediately start making those changes. Get the new version up on the screen, and it becomes an effort of or an exercise in creating things fast on the fly, catching errors and glitches before they're on a giant screen, and having a really critical eye for turnaround times. It's crazy. It's a rush.
So why is the revision process and the turnaround time situation like that? I mean, is it just because, you know, if you're doing a commercial for a client, that commercial is the product. But what you're doing is not the product. The concert is the product. And so is it just because everything's kind of secondary to the overall experience of the concert?
So it's similar to it's similar to the client of a music video. You're dealing with an artist. Like you're doing another artist's works. Like with Coca-Cola or IBM or, you know, any like big client, there's like 45 art directors that are all like, I don't know, I think blue. Well, maybe blue, maybe purple. Maybe purple, maybe purple blue. Maybe purplish blue, purplish green. Can we see a version with each one? And then it comes back and then someone goes like, no, I said red.
Right.
With the artist, like, you could end up with the artist's best friend sitting over your shoulder going, like, they'll never like that. No. No. It's like throwing stuff away in your room, in your pit, and, like, there's no real way to, like, navigate the client agency, client studio. Like, it's just, like, everything's real intimate and like, you're creating a stage show, and they're nervous about the stage show. They don't know how it's going to be received. You don't know how it's going to be received. So there's this shared ball of, like, stress and happiness. And then opening night happens, first show goes off, and, like, I mean, I probably cried a little bit at every single concert that I've worked on, like, opening night.
Just out of exhaustion, right?
No, just, like it's so weird. Like, I think it's what got me the most, like, high was, like, sitting on the floor. No, not sitting, but standing on the floor in general, looking at everyone, like, flip out, like, the artists going crazy. Like, the best performers are, like, the ones that, like, their fans are so intense, and you have the stuff that you've created in their backdrop, their songs, lighting, costume, everything's, like, aesthetically tied together, and then the audience is going nuts. You've already seen the concert, like, 15, 20 times before it goes off, but once you've seen it transform into an actual experience, it's mind-blowing to be part of it, to have, like, a small bit of the energy in that room where that artist or rock star is just generating all of this love and excitement. Just to have a small piece of that was exhilarating.
So how much of that, you know, you mentioned that the video elements that you're creating a lot of times will tie in with, like, the lighting setup, and maybe there's even a theme for the tour. How much of that comes from you guys, like, from what, you know, you or whoever's doing the work, and how much comes from the artist? Like, do they come to you with sort of a, here's our brand guidelines, this is the patriotic tour, we want everything to be patriotic, or does some of that come from you?
So there's usually a show director involved who handles, like, lighting and stage setup and screen design and everything, and they usually have a little bit of an idea for what the tour is going to be. And that's one of the things that takes, that's one of the reasons why the turnaround time gets sort of orchestrated. Like, you'll have a few ideas, and you'll have, like, some Pinterest boards for each song, and they'll be all over the place. And then suddenly the artist would be like, no, it's not chrome and diamonds for blah, blah, blah. Now it's rock and smoke. And it's like, ah, damn it. We just animated 2.5 minutes of chrome and diamonds. Now we have to animate 2.5 minutes of rock and smoke. Okay. All right. Fine. And then you'll sit with your content on the screen, and then the lighting director and the show director will start, you know, playing with the lighting setup and smoke, and they'll start seeing how everything feels. And then sometimes they'll adjust the lighting to accommodate the video content, because that's easier to do that. But it's sort of like everything works together. Like, no one, like, the show director is really in charge, and then the artist, in the best of relationships.
So is it, you know, so you said Tim and Faith, I'm assuming you mean Tim McGraw, Faith Hill.
Yeah.
Are they coming to your, you know, looking over your shoulder and After Effects is open or Cinema 4D? Are they like art directing this thing, or do they have people, you know, is Bono throwing client revisions at you?
Tim was pretty into it. I don't think he ever shouldered anyone, but we were at the Venetian Theater in Las Vegas, and our computers were set up in, like, the middle walkway row with our render farm right to the side of us, and then all the screens were right in front of us. So he would just come stand, like, up on a chair and watch content run through, and then be like, oh, you know, instead of that thing that just happened when I said, can you have it do, like, something different?
Yeah, that's this is another thing I was curious about. That was an amazing impression of Tim McGraw, by the way. Sounds exactly like him. So, you know, I'm imagining for Lady Gaga that she's got, you know, sort of this master, you know, like a Pro Tools rig somewhere, and someone hits spacebar, and then the show plays, and she's got musicians playing along, and she's singing, obviously, but the whole thing's on rails, right? So you can sync your content up to it. But how does it work for, like, U2, right? Because they're just a rock band. I'm assuming they don't have this show on rails, or maybe they do. How does the synchronization happen between your content and the music?
So Lady Gaga, some songs would be on what was called a click track. Sometimes it'd be on what's called a time code. Sometimes there'd be just a loose thing. Lady Gaga was difficult because we at Zoic created a bunch of looks, and then the guys at Timber, Kevin Lau and Jonah Hall, they made a bunch of looks too. And then we kept throwing stuff away, working with this girl, Nicole Ehrlich, who handles like all of her concerts. We ended up just throwing stuff and stuff away, throwing it away. And then Lady Gaga said, I want to work with this photographer that I used on a couple other things. Her name is Ruth Hogben. And they spent an entire day at this stage and just shot tons of stuff, like slow-mo glitter, slow-mo flowers, slow-mo feathers, Lady Gaga on a swing, and a ton of weird stuff. And then Lady Gaga said, like, all looks are out. I want everything she sought to be in the show. So then we started making, like, treatments from the footage and edits and doing all the click track. And then like, with U2, that was actually – U2 was, like, one of this new software called, like, Notch. It's a real-time, like, solution. That sort of got born on that Innocence and Experience tour. But for the stuff that we made that was pre-rendered, we worked with – it was mainly, like, interludes and songs that were going to have a click track. If they weren't going to have a click track or a time code or interludes, then they did a lot of real-time stuff using D3 and Notch because then they could do whatever they wanted. They got to go, like, full artist mode, develop a real-time look, and go from there.
Oh, that makes sense. So – because in my head, I was thinking, okay, you're essentially animating a music video with no artist in it, and then the artist performs in sync with it. But you're saying that another way is you create sort of like a toolkit, and then you're triggering things almost like a VJ?
Yeah, sometimes there would be like a click track layout for certain things, but there's a few songs that were just straight up like real-time effects that were happening on all the screens based on footage that was being captured by cameras placed around the stage. So like there was one song that had a Kinect involved on the Innocence Experience tour, I believe. I think I'm allowed to say that. I don't know.
It's funny. I actually just recently saw U2. They did a tour where they played the entire Joshua Tree album.
Right.
And they had a lot of really crazy camera effects. And one of them kind of looked like a Kinect. It was pretty amazing. And I was wondering how they were doing that. But it was also cut together with, like, you know, motion graphics and video and things that were clearly made to be in sync with a song. So it sounds like at this point, at the high end, you're doing a combo.
Yeah, you got to do a combo because it's impossible to make the pre-render graphics like updatable for an improvisational show. But the real-time stuff like Notch and D3 and Touch Designer, that stuff allows artists to just kind of like, you just kind of create like a particular preset in Notch and be like, all right, so this is going to take in live camera B and then it's going to do this displacement effect over it. So wherever he walks on the stage, if camera B, A, C, or D are on him, then screens 1 through 8 are going to play this projection to the audience, and you can set up all these cool motion triggers and stuff. It's really fun working with that stuff.
Oh my God, that sounds super cool. All right, so how do you, you know, some of the stuff you've done, you know, looks like there's multiple screens, you know, synced up and some, they're all different sizes and shapes. And sometimes there's even sort of like projection mapped stuff where you have to kind of create it in perspective and project it. How do you test that stuff on it before the stage itself is even built and you're able to see what it looks like?
Almost always that stuff has a CAD model involved. So we'll do like projection man or just regular camera projection in cinema on the stage and create like perspective throws for where the projectors are going to be. If it's projectors, there's almost always a 3D file that has where projectors are going to be positioned for specific arenas and the stage as a 3D model. So you just kind of like, sometimes you'll throw a texture on a light and point it at the stage and do like light projections in cinema, but almost always we'll simulate the environment inside Cinema 4D to generate a pre-visualization of how the projections are going to be thrown.
Oh, okay. And then so when the, you know, in the initial phase is when the artist is looking at your ideas, you're sort of showing them this is what it will look like on the stage.
Yep. Well, like on Lady Gaga, she had this crazy like inflatable thing that was, it was going to be impossible to projection map on. So we had to come up with like basically like all our initial looks were like textural things that led themselves to being warped and displaced, and like anything that looked good bending or looked weird bending, that was what we went with, because there was no way we were ever going to get a UV map to stick with a projector, because there was no setup time for any show to allow calibration of any sort of projection software. So it basically had to be, with the sloppiest amount of mapping, what looks best.
That's super cool, man. So, I mean, the stuff that you're talking about now, this is really interesting to me, because, you know, when I came into this industry and when you came in, everything was just on this flat screen. You know, it was like a commercial or it was like part of a TV show. And now it's coming off of that, and you're projecting shit in real time and mixing it and putting it in front of Lady Gaga. So I want to talk a little bit about sort of the future of all of this stuff, but I'm curious if you know, what sorts of budgets do these big artists put towards the motion graphics part of their concerts?
None. I don't know. You know, I can't talk about any specifics of any specific artists, but
oh, of course, yeah.
You know, it ranges. It ranges from, you know, 500,000-600,000 to as small as like 120. Like,
yeah. I guess the reason I ask is because, you know, I have friends who are music video directors, and you know the quality of the music videos they produce, you'd look at it and be like, wow, that should cost about $170,000. But they don't. They cost $5,000, and they're done for prestige. And so I was curious if this if concert, you know, live visuals industry is that. Is it a prestige thing that you do once or twice to get it on your reel and make a name for yourself, and then you don't do it anymore because you'll be bankrupt? Or is it actually – are these artists paying for your time and what it's worth?
I always got paid my time, and I always made sure my teams got paid their time, and I never asked for anyone to give me a rate reduction for a concert.
Yep.
Maybe I asked. I may have asked. There's going to be someone who comes out on Twitter being like, "He asked me for a rate reduction."
Son of a bitch.
But no, I always want to have fair payment, and if your day rate's $600 to $800 a day, and then say that's your day rate, you know, like, and if they go like, oh, well, this is for Usher and his new tour, and it's gonna be a really big deal. Everyone by now knows what to say to that email. You say like, oh, cool, well, have fun with no fucking team.
Right. Been there.
Yeah. Like, you know, if anyone ever asks, the prestige is not currency. It's like, you know, that doesn't pay, you know, daycare or cell phone or, you know.
Yeah, exactly.
Plural site.
Yeah. You know, Instagram likes don't buy diapers, unfortunately, you know?
Yeah.
All right. So let's talk about your current gig a little bit. You mentioned that you were doing something with AR, which, just in case anyone doesn't know, augmented reality. And I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit about that, because, you know, the motion design field is sort of turning into this octopus that's kind of like, oh, let me get into this live projection mapping thing, and let me get into virtual reality. And now there's augmented reality. And I'm really interested to see how all of these skills are being used. So what specifically are you doing for Silence in the AR world?
So we created a augmented reality like basically data reader for a product we make called Silence Optics, which basically takes sort of like the black box of AV. When our flagship product protects, stops, and quarantines a threat, there's data that's generated that's sort of like a who, what, where, when, why, and how of the quarantine threat. And Optics looks at that data and says, like, this is a file. It tried to open a PowerShell and save a file in temp directory, and then it was going to try to extract data from this, and so that generates like a CSV. And they wanted to show this world of the basic goal that I wanted out of it, and the creative director Drew Hoffman. We wanted to be able to start a conversation with analysts and marketing and incident response people about what makes data valuable and what visibility gives to researchers. So we have six HoloLenses, and we'd put them on everyone, and we'd load up the data, and at trade shows, we'd, you know, our field research for is this working, are we doing this right, was at Black Hat and RSA, these huge cybersecurity trade shows. And we'd say, like, this is our data visualization of threat data. where this is why we're displaying it this way, this is what this value means. I'm speaking in ambiguities, not because the project is a secret, just I don't have anything to share with you guys in the links to make this visual for you. But the idea is with a HoloLens on, I can look you in the eye and you can look me in the eye. If you point at something, I see what you're pointing at. And there's something in there that is revolutionary in nature. Looking at a table with a display rendered amount of data that everyone can stand around and collaborate with is game-changing in a lot of ways. Man, revolutionary and game-changing.
Dude, it's like a commercial. Let me ask you this. I'm super curious about the HoloLens, just on a dorky level. You know, I've put on the Oculus, I've put on the Vive, but like what, you know, the HoloLens is one of these things that's like hard to find in the wild. What's the quality of the visual that it's putting in front of your eyeballs?
It's a little to be, there's much to be desired. The field of view is a bit narrow, and it looks like you're sort of looking through a mail slot. But with all of those things withstanding, once you see a hologram in front of you, in front of a person, it's mind-blowing. It's like, whoa, like I'm looking at the future. Like, I've had similar experiences with some really well-designed VR things, but the first time I put a HoloLens on, I was like, this is absolutely like the next generation of desktop assistants. Like, this is going to be huge because there's no cables, there's no computer involved. It's 100% a self-contained system that provides the application or the holographic application in front of your vision that you then interact with your hands.
That is pretty insane. And now, you know, with the new iPhone, it has AR kit. There's going to be a lot of AR, you know, content coming out. So are you still using similar tools to work on AR? Are you using Cinema 4D and, you know, X particles, things like that, or is it a totally different ballgame?
Yep, still Cinema 4D, X particles, and Houdini. I work with people that use Unity. I'm trying to learn Unity, but it's one of those things where it's like, sure, I could learn Unity. I could figure it out, and that can be a thing that I use all the time. Or I could just like stop. I could collaborate with someone or hire someone who's like better at it, you know, and get a better result and learn from them that way. And the game engine stuff, that's honestly where I think people should be looking. Like that's the true future.
Yeah. I'd love for you to elaborate a little bit more about that, because I've heard a lot of people say that, and I've played around with Unity years ago when AR first sort of came out. There was a plugin for Unity called Vuforia. You could print out a QR code and point your iPad or your iPhone at it and have something happen. And you could basically build an animation in Cinema 4D, export it to Unity, and with a couple lines of code, it would be triggered by seeing that QR code. And it was mind-blowing. And I thought the same thing. This is the future, but the tech, the tools to do it are still in two different worlds, Cinema 4D and Unity. And from what I understand, Unity isn't hard to learn, but the coding part, the interactivity part, if you're doing data visualization, you're writing code, I imagine. Do you think that artists should be starting to spend a little more time in code land and trying to get that, you know, get a grip on that? Or do you think that the industry is going to split and you're going to still have traditional motion design on this side? And then on the other side, you're going to have the coders who figure all that stuff out.
I don't know. I mean, like, should you learn to program? 100%. Like, there's no, like, if you look at salaries for, like, look at a salary for a data science person, like an engineer who is working for like an AI company or who's just doing basic scripting and programming. The demand for someone who can program is through the roof.
Right.
Like, look at like the successful people on AE scripts, the people that are like creating scripts that fix functionality within things, like plugin developers for Cinema. There's all these markets for programmers that are way beyond the market reach of like just making style frames. It's a totally different thing. If you look at like Houdini, you can now build like Unity and game shaders inside that you can export over to Unity or Unreal when you're working on it. Like, Houdini's integration with Unreal and Unity is becoming insanely integrated. They're really trying to like just Borg into all of the applications. And Cinema's, to an extent, is pretty pretty impressive as well. Like, you can open up a Cinema 4D file in Unity and it'll generate an FBX for you, which is really good for like creating level designs and stuff in Cinema. But If you look at the curve to learn of Unreal Engine or Unity or whatever Amazon's, what is it called, Campfire, Firehouse, Firetown?
I don't even know.
Okay. The difficulty to learn a game engine 5 years ago was not that bad. It was hard, but it was not that bad. Today, it's a lot easier. And 10 years ago, it would have been impossible for someone in motion design to wrap their head around a game engine. It was just not a thing that was available. It was expensive as hell. And they were all proprietary. But now we have like Touch Designer, which is basically a game engine, but it's like a real-time interactive thing. Unity, which is insanely, it's like the Cinema 4D of game engines, really.
Yeah.
But yeah, Ryan Summers tweeted the other day, he was like, we're all going to be using game engines in 5 years. And I snidely responded, not all of you. Some of you will be making explainer videos for the companies we've started using game engines.
So you're saying there's hope. That's good. that's fascinating, man. It'll be interesting to listen back to this episode in 5 years and see where the industry is. Because I'm with you. I think that, you know, once VR and AR become mainstream, once an Oculus isn't, you know, it doesn't weigh 15 pounds and cost $800. I think there's going to be a lot of work out there. Kind of like, you know, on the other end, you've got UX and UI kind of app prototyping. That's the other kind of big new, brave new world for motion design. And, you know, so I think the call to learn a little bit of programming, just enough code to be able to get by, is super duper good advice. Casey, I just want to say thank you for spending so much time talking about all this. I feel like we could probably geek out on a bunch of stuff for hours and hours, but I don't want to take up more of your time. So I just want to say thanks for coming. And we're going to link to all of Casey's stuff in the show notes. And go check out his work. It is incredible.
Oh, thanks, man. Yeah, I feel like I just looked up and saw that we've been going for an hour and 15 minutes. And I was like, dude, we could easily go for another 45 minutes.
Yeah, no problem. But we'll just have to do round two in a little bit.
Cool. That sounds fine with me. I'll be happy to come back.
All of the sites, tools, and work we mentioned can be found in the show notes on our site. And make sure to check out Casey's work at xkcx.com. And be on the lookout for Cinema 4D Basecamp, coming soon from School of Motion. Sign up for free on our site to get notifications about new courses like that one, plus a whole bunch of other really sweet stuff. Thank you so much for listening. I hope you have an incredible day, and we'll meet again soon.